We were on the definition of diabetic ketoacidosis. As I talked about, P250, there will be ketosis. Ketosis is the presence of ketone bodies in the blood, and there will be acidemia. Acidemia is when pH is less than 7.3. Why it happens? It come, you know, as the role of insulin is in muscle, in the fat, in the liver. It induces transport of glucose, and then it inhibits lipolysis. So in the absence of insulin, the glucose for gluconeogenesis is even uses fatty acids for gluconeogenesis, and the fatty acids in turns get converted into acetone, acetoacetate, and beta-hydroxybutyrate. So this is a diagrammatic presentation of how insulin acts, how it inhibits glycogenolysis, it inhibits gluconeogenesis, and it further induces glucose uptake in the liver and the muscles and the fats. And then you see what happens in the insulin deficiency. I mean, it will be more secretion of glucagon. You will have hepatic glucose output will increase, and there will be decrease insulin stimulated transport of glucose. And as the at what happens in diabetic ketoacidosis, you will pretty hormones, and there will be a decreased uptake of glucose into the muscles and the fat. There will be generation of free fatty acid and free amino acids. And since their sugar will be available in the plasma, but it won't be utilized. It won't utilize with the fat and the muscles. So they will be in a state of starvation. They will need energy, and that energy will come from these fatty acids and amino acid, which has to be taken up for energy generation. And that is how, through the beta oxidation of the fatty acid in the liver, you will have ketone bodies in the blood. So what happens as there is an unchecked gluconeogenesis, there is a hyperglycemia. As there is a hyperglycemia, you will have osmotic diuresis, and there will be more outpouring of urine, a concentrated urine, and that will lead to further dehydration as the intravascular volume gets depleted, and there will be unchecked ketogenesis. This unchecked ketogenesis will cause ketosis. So as ketosis, as the blood gets acidic, this will lead to dissociation of ketone into hydrogen ions and anions. And to compensate for that, there will be anion gap metabolic acidosis. And as there will be generation of more hydrogen ion, the bicarbonate ion will decrease in the body. There will be further acidosis, and ventilation that will come in the next slide. Then the precipitating events. Diabetic ketoacidosis usually happens in type 1 diabetes, where there is insulin deficiency, either due to the inefficient administration of insulin, or there will be skipping of insulin on a regular basis. Supposedly, a patient is administering insulin twice a day, and he has been skipping once a dose for on a regular basis. So there will be inadequate insulin administration that will can lead to ketosis. And then there would be infection, any underlying infection, pneumonia, UTI, or gastroenteritis, or sepsis, or it can be a pregnancy induced because of the stress hormone, or there'd be drug induced like cocaine, or there'd be in a state of infarction. Are you able to hear me? Class, are you able to hear me? We'll take a pause if you're able to hear me. If there is no technical glitch. Okay, fine. We'll go back to our slides. So what happens in ketoacidosis? How the patient will manifest? Since there will be hyperglycemia, there will be polyuria and polydipsia. Polyuria is increase in urinary frequency, and polydipsia increase in the thirst mechanism, as the thirst receptor is eased down. There will be a tendency to drink a large volume of water, and there will be severe volume because of the intravascular volume depletion, there can be renal hypoperfusion, pre-renal azotemia, and that can lead to hypotension and shock. So initially, the patient might, you will have all this polyuria and gradually as the renal azotemia sets in, the patient might be oligouric. Oligouric is decreased urinary output. Then ketones will lead to acidosis, and that can lead to compensatory respiratory alkalosis, that is a hyperventilation, washing out of the respiratory carbon dioxide, and that will present as a Kussmaul respiration. Then there could be a further hypotension and shock. So again, the patient will come to you with a thirst, polyuria. There can be a very significant symptom is abdominal pain. The patient might come to you with just with the abdominal pain, and that might trigger or might mimic an acute emergency, an acute abdominal pain, and it will be mimic an emergency. But that is basically because of diabetic ketoacidosis. And they might come to you with nausea and vomiting because of the ketones. It tends to stimulate the postrema receptors in the brain, and that can lead to nausea and vomiting. And then can be definitely be profound weakness, and there will be mental can be a certain altered or irrelevant behavior. Physical examination will find Kussmaul respiration. We talked about Kussmaul is a deep hyperventilation, ventilating patient, or trying to take a deep expiration to wash out the carbon dioxide from the body to compensate for the metabolic acidosis. Then there will be fruity breath because of the acetone, because this is one of the ketone acetone which is being exhaled through the respiratory tract. And because of the dehydration, you can have tachycardia, this increase in heart rate, and then you can have a poor skin turgor, or because of the dehydration, dry mucus, membrane, then you can have abdominal tenderness that might mimic a surgical emergency. So these are the respiratory events. Patient comes with polyuria, polydipsia, dehydration, there will be anorexia, nausea, vomiting. These all that will lead to respiratory ketone Kussmaul respiration, then that might eventually lead to altered consciousness or cardiovascular collapse, and eventually in some cases the patient might that might lead to coma and death. So this whole year, the whole sequence of event, it happens within a span of 5 minutes. When a patient with type 1 diabetes and it comes to you with signs of dehydration, acidotic deep breathing, abdominal pain, or incessant vomiting, or anyone with an altered mental status. So to make a diagnosis, you look for the major metabolic derangements, which were hyperglycemia, ketosis, and metabolic acidosis. Hyperglycemia, obviously the blood sugar level will be more than 250, and acidosis, you will have pH less than 7.3, low bicarbonate level less than 15, and ketone in the blood, ketone in the urine. That is how you will detect ketosis. So management, because it's a state of dehydration and insulin insufficiency, first you will try to diagnose DKA, and you should take a proper history, do a baseline investigation, and start with something like proper hydration. First of all, you will address the hydration, and then you start with the insulin infusion to control the blood sugar level. And the one important aspect is you have to look for dyslipidemia, which will be present in such patients. So you have to even address hyponatremia and the potassium level of the body. So you have to look for all the signs of dehydration, acidosis, hypotension, any signs of heated infection. Of glucose and ketones, APG, acid-base gas analysis, then the treatment phase first and most importantly is careful replacement of fluid deficit. So as the fluid deficit is taken care of, the blood sugar level normalizes, and even the electrolytic abnormalities normalizes, and the ketosis is taken care of. That and further with the IV insulin administration, the acidosis and hyperglycemia is properly taken care of. And usually the decay has to be managed in the ICU, and since it takes mostly in the type 1 pediatric patients more. As you know, the blood sugar level, because in a
Welcome and thank you for choosing freeconferencecall.com. You're helping people around the world communicate for free. There are 121 participants in the conference. All participants are muted. Welcome and thank you for choosing freeconferencecall.com. You're helping people around the world communicate for free. There are 122 participants in the conference. All participants are muted. All participants are muted.
Are you able to hear me? And are you able to see the slides? I'm so sorry for the technical issue. Can't be helped. Are you able to hear me? And slides? Are you able to see the slides? I haven't magnified it. Are you able to hear the slides? I'm going to maximize it. Chalo, so we are talking about the intravascular aspect. We have to correct the intravascular volume dehydration. I was talking about in the hyperglycemia state will be a decrease in a serum sodium level. For every 100 milliequivalent of glucose increase, there will be 1.6 milliequivalent of sodium decrease. That's a normal compensate for the dehydration. We have to soon switch over to 0.45% saline in order to take care of the because there was there might be enhancement as the glucose level gets controlled. There might that might and the dehydration gets corrected. It might lead to hypernatremia, that is increase in sodium level. So I have so two things here have to be very particular about, that you have to check ABG and serum even address the kind of volume you are administering. I am are you able to hear me now? Because there has been a electrical problem with the electricity. There's been fluctuation in the electricity. Are you able to hear me? Are you able to see the slides? Is it going on uninterrupted? Then I'll continue. So fine. So the second thing is, as we administer the fluid, and over the period of 2 to 3 days, we try to compensate for the dehydration, and serum as the serum glucose also gets controlled, because along with the fluid, we will start with the IV insulin administration, that will come in the next slide, and as the serum glucose reaches .45 saline as a rate, that will allow complete restoration and complete compensation of acidosis in with a period of 48 hours, and we'll try to maintain blood glucose level around 150 to 250 milligram. And again, the reason behind the initiation of dextrose, because there might because of the correction of glucose should not be very sudden. And the patient might not that because the correction, if it is very subtle, and the patient will fall in hypoglycemia, and that would lead to another adverse. We are trying to correct on the one hand, we're trying to correct the hyperglycemia. We don't want the patient to fall into the hyperglycemia, and that will lead to another kind of adverse effects and cardiovascular risk. So that's why we, as soon as the glucose gets to 250 level, we start with the 5% dextrose. And the insulin therapy is the another the crux of the treatment. So there's insulin deficiency. We'll try to infuse a bolus of 0.1 unit per kg of insulin along with the insulin pump or insulin infusion pump at a rate of 0.1 unit per kg per hour. And it will be in the form of regular insulin, because it has to be in administered IV. And if the patient, if it's as soon as we start administering insulin, we'll try sugar level should not be more than 150 to 100 milligram per hour, because if there will be a sudden decline of blood sugar level or can lead to ensuing cerebral edema, because as we have the hypertonicity or the hyperosmolar state, and if there will be a sudden changes in the plasma osmolarity, that can lead to cerebral edema. So we will correct it subtly, and as soon as the sugar level falls to around 200-250, prior to correction of the acidosis, will change to IV fluid from D5 to D10, and we'll continue with the insulin infusion. So this is the basic outline which you should remember. And as the insulin infusion continues, the acidosis is cleared and bicarbonate comes back to the normal, and anion gap is normalized and pH then come back to normal. The correction of acidosis, as the insulin therapy stops lipolysis and it promotes metabolism of ketone bodies, and the bicarbonate is not administered until unless there is a severe acidosis. So as the acidosis is corrected, urine ketone bodies appear to, first of all, will appear to rise. So it won't be a prognostic value on DKA. To the previous insulin doses, at which the sugar as what the patient was taking. And the other thing is, we have also have to calculate the insulin requirement based on the insulin requirement of the patient and the insulin deficiency of the patient. We can even try to optimize a newer insulin dose for the patient. And one important thing we should never miss out, as we said about the there is a chances of hyponatremia, there is regardless of potassium concentration, you know the unary body potassium is low. You know, because of the acidosis, the serum, because of the acidosis, the serum potassium level will be high or normal, but still the body potassium is low. Why? Because of the incessant vomiting, and because of the diuresis, and then because of the ketosis or the acidosis, the body potassium will be, the total body potassium will be less. So even when the potassium level is low normal, we will try to supplement it with IV fluid with 20 to 40 millimole of KCl, which is to be given. And the thing is, it can be given in 50% as a KCl or other 50% as a potassium phosphate. And until unless the potassium level is because the body is, because the patient is in a state of the total body potassium is low. But if the serum potassium comes to be more than 5.5, that's just more than or upper limit of the normal, we can we don't need to administer potassium, because there can be the risk of hyperkalemia. So it is a very ambiguous situation. We have to, even since the total body potassium is low, we even have to administer potassium when the serum potassium level is shows normal, because we know the total body potassium is less, and the chances of again while administering the potassium, we should be also be very careful that serum potassium doesn't rise more than 5.5, that because there are chances of hyperkalemia too. So the criteria for resolution of DKA, once the DKA is resolved, you will have glucose level within 200, serum bicarbonate more than 18, and pH of more than 7.3. So if the patient is NPO, once DKA is resolved, we can continue with intravenous insulin or fluid replacement. If the patient is not NPO, the patient can be switched back to their normal level. So this is once DKA is resolved, and the patient can be weaned off the IV insulin by giving subcutaneous insulin. Shifted back to the normal insulin level. And the other condition is hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state. So the hyperosmolar hyperglycemic is again a state of extreme hyperglycemia, but there won't be ketosis because usually this takes place in the diabetes type 2 patients, because there will be a relative deficiency of insulin or the resistance of insulin, but there won't be the absolute inefficiency or deficiency of insulin. So that's why there might be a hyperglycemia, but it would be manifest without ketosis. And precipitating factors can be similarly will be like stroke or sepsis, but it is again a potentially deadly as much as DKA, and mortality may exceed 30 to 40%. And the precipitants are, as I said, the five I's we talked about: infection, infarction, insulin deficiency or complication or intoxication, any renal failure or hyperglycemia inducing medications like steroid or cocaine. So again, you will have the acute stresses or increased secretion of the counter-regulatory hormones. And as you say, there will be relative insulin deficiency, and that will lead to hyperglycemia, and then again will be polyuria, and again volume depletion. So what is very important to notice, the blood sugar level might be extremely high in case of hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state. It might be in the range of be again because of the hyperglycemia will be overt, the hemoconcentration will be overt, so the volume depletion will be overt, and the serum osmolarity will be more than 330. The normal is 285 to 295. So as there will be as increased hyperviscosity, increased risk of thrombosis, disturbmentation, neurological signs in the form of cerebral edema or focal, which will manifest as a focal signs of seizures. Then there will be motor abnormalities like flaccidity or depressed reflexes. And without treatment, patient will definitely go in for coma and death. See, treatment is on the similar lines to DKA. You have to correct for the volume depletion. You have the replacement of the electrolytes be taken care of. And then the IV insulin, as the infusion has to be started. And then you have to be treated along the same line as DKA. Then the other thing about diabetes are chronic complications. We talked about the micro and macrovascular complications. But before that, I'll talk about the hypoglycemia. This is another one of the acute emergency. I hope you are able to hear me. There's no technical issues right now. So again, hypoglycemia is another one of the complications. So we can manifest, we can even think of it as a complication of diabetes, where a serum glucose level is less than 55 milligram. It can be brain damage, and the brain is deprived of needed glucose after, and the insulin, there will be, as the insulin low, you will have the causes can be overdose of insulin or OHA. There will be increase, you or the patient might have skipped on the meals, and they have taken up their normal routine OHA or insulin. Other than me, a patient might be in a state of overexertion, or patient would have intense exercise and he wouldn't have taken a proper meal afterwards, or there might be have been an incident of eating late and you might have taken up OHA or insulin at the wrong time, or there can be unplanned exercise. There can be several causes, and usually manifestation will be diaphoresis, is increased sweating, pallor, paresthesia, palpitations, tremor, anxiety. These all are the autonomic hyperactivity as the sugar levels goes down, and the counter-regulatory hormone is like epinephrine and norepinephrine, and glucagon is it's prevalent in the body, and that will lead to increase a sympathetic manifestation. So hyperglycemia can be moderate. Patient will yawn, there might be a blurring of vision, and even the severe cases can lead to seizure, loss of consciousness, and shallow respiration. And a severe hypoglycemia can be a cardiovascular risk, and it may result to death. So you, for diagnosis, you have to see the signs and symptoms. You have to get a sugar blood level to be done, a random blood sugar level or fasting blood sugar level. And the management is mild as you can give. Best is to give a oral simple sugar, like a 15 gram of a rapid acting sugar, 8 ounces of fruit juice or 8 ounces of skim milk or 3 glucose tablets or even a soft drink of 3 to 4 ounces. Or any candy of 3 to 4 pieces of 1 teaspoon of sugar or of 5 ml pure honey, anything, and by the oral route, or then you can monitor blood glucose level even 15 minutes later, and if still low, then you can again give another 15 gram of sugar and continue until the blood glucose level has come to the normal. And if the event, the hypoglycemic events occur more frequently, then you should contact a doctor. And in case of unconscious patient, then you have to immediately administer glucagon 1 milligram subcutaneous IM or IV. And even the other thing is you can give 25 ml of water. Now talking about the chronic complication of microvascular, you know about diabetic retinopathy, then you have diabetic nephropathy and diabetic neuropathy. And diabetic retinopathy is due to hyperglycemia, damage to the tiny blood vessels that supply the eye, the small hemorrhages, and leads to retinal ischemia and breakdown of blood retinal barriers. And you see the on the fundoscopy, you will find this a progressive irreversible vision loss, pool of blood or hemorrhage on the retina of an eye. And you can find, this is a EMI photograph here, electromicroscopy photograph, you will find the exudates and microaneurysms. This is a non-peripheric diabetic retinopathy, this is a peripheric diabetic retinopathy. You can see the aneurysm, hemorrhages, hard exudates, and what's read about all this in your ophthalmology. Then you see the retinopathy, you have medical management for retinopathy is a laser treatment and control, your preventive measures are control hypertension, control blood glucose, stay away from smoking, and yearly examination of the eyes. Diabetic nephropathy is a very common, usually in type 1 diabetes, 10 to 15 years it takes place, and it occurs as soon as the type 2 diabetes have been detected, because many of the type 2 diabetes are undiagnosed for years. Glycemia, there will be more protein leak into the urine, and as the pressure in the blood vessels of the kidney increases because of the glomerulosclerosis will take place, the patchy glomerulosclerosis will take place on the glomerular levels, and it can lead to kidney failure. So the nephropathy is basically the diabetes damage the system, filter starts to leak, you will have microalbuminuria, lead to macroalbuminuria and proteinuria, and loss of filtering ability can lead to renal failure, end-stage renal failure. And the treatment is you have to address all this, but you have to have a tight blood glucose control, antihypertensive to be administered, the best is ACE inhibitors, and is and you have to have, if once the patient falls in for renal failure, he goes in for a chronic renal failure, patient might be put on dialysis or he might need a renal transplant. So basic pathology, diabetic glomerulosclerosis, which is characterized by basal membrane thickening and mesangial cell proliferation. Then neuropathy, which is the most common, symmetrical neuropathy is the most common complication, and it involves the distal extremity with stocking glove distribution, the decreased vibration, temperature, and proprioception. Initially present patient may present with painful paresthesia, burning, and pins, and then recognized trauma. And damage to the nerves again due to hyperglycemia, and the most common is sensory motor neuropathy and autonomic neuropathy. And sensory motor neuropathy, as we talked about, will be paresthesia primarily in the lower extremities to lead to numbness of the feet. Deep tendon reflexes might decrease, decreased proprioception, decreased sensation, and the gait might be unsteady, and there will be increased risk of foot injury. neuropathy, an autonomic neuropathy, you will have gastric paresis, constipation or diarrhea, chronic edema, postural hypotension, cardiac dysrhythmia, impotency. As you can see, the autonomic system can affect cardiovascular system in the form of orthostatic hypotension or MI or tachycardia, GIT in the form of delayed gastric emptying, constipation or diarrhea, urinary can have a uneurogenic bladder, and reproductive, as you talked about, there'll be kind of male impotency and adrenal gland hypoglycemic unawareness is one of the manifestation where even in the presence of hypoglycemia, the patient might not be unaware at the end. The typical features of hypoglycemic effects like sympathetic mimetics like paresthesia, palpitation, sweating, that might not take place, and the patient would straight away land up in coma. So that is about this hypoglycemic unawareness. This is so dangerous. Role in frequent monitoring. And for pain control, you can start on analgesics, or you can even try tricyclic antidepressant or anticonvulsant in the form of pregabalin and gabapentin, or even valproate then can be used. Then a macrovascular complication, which is gangrene, is 14 times more common in people with diabetes, and coronary heart diseases is very common, and it can occur in the early ages, and it is the most important part is because we talked about the autonomic neuropathy, so it can occur without chest pain. The other diabetic complication can happen in pregnancy, mother increased insulin requirement during pregnancy, diabetic retinopathy, and problem for the babies. With the babies of the diabetic mother can have congenital malformation, there will be a macrosomia, and we can have a chances of respiratory distress syndrome. And as we talked about the other complication, you will have peripheral vascular diseases, you can have a high risk of foot infection, and as the infection or foot infection increases with age, with smoking, and it will lead to soft tissue injury. And this is what happens when you have the gangrenes of the dead tissue in the part of the body. So you have management of the infection with the antibiotic, debridement, glucose control, and even can lead to amputation. So this is all about complication, and this is all about diabetes. Any query, you can just push in your questions, and we'll address your questions in the next class when I talk about, we'll start with the thyroid hormone. If you have any problem with this class, with the complications or with the treatment of diabetic ketoacidosis, but you can we can address all those issues about diabetes in the next class. Thank you so much. We're already late, so I'll sign off for now. Thank you so much.